The views and opinions expressed by John and DJ do not reflect those of any intelligent or rational human being and are solely the property of the Brightside Chat.
This show is a proud member of the Nerdy Legion Podcast Network. Get more at nerdylegion.com. Enjoy the show!
Hey, welcome back to the Brightside and issue number 124. Karmen from Image Comics. We didn't have to wait this week.
What, with the title?
Yeah, with the title.
No, I mean, I knew what it was before we started, which is unusual.
Yeah, I had already typed it into the show note.
That put undue pressure on me right from the jump.
It put undue pressure on you?
Yeah.
Why?
Because I had to have something to talk about. Like, I already got the pressure this afternoon when I saw Twitter, and I was like, well, I guess I better read that.
and I better like it.
I'm going to be required to talk about it.
Yeah. Oh, we had a good discussion about it, though. You weren't as excited as I was, but you did like it.
I did like it, but I guess I didn't find it to have as many talking points as you did.
But was I wrong? We had a great conversation about it. Yeah.
But I felt like it was more straightforward.
Right. Well, I'm not as smart as you, John. It took me a little longer. I need you to explain it.
Or you're
it
smarter
to me.
And you saw more in it than I did. I'm a simple man, you know. I take things at face value.
Yeah, and as we say in the show, you're also Mr. Brightside.
That's right.
So people got that to look forward to. And tons of WandaVision talk.
Yes. For the last time, unfortunately.
Yeah, for the last time. It'll never be the last time.
Well, not that it might come up again at some point, but...
Well, we'll probably talk about it again next week because we'll have nothing next week.
Right,
so.
We have nothing else to talk about.
No other shows. Yeah. So next week's show is going to be like, what, 20 minutes long?
Yep.
Yeah, so really good show, great books, lots of stuff. Check us out on YouTube, lots of pictures on YouTube we loaded up this week for you.
Yeah.
So...
You really brought the work.
Yep, I tried. And he's taken my word for it. He hasn't even seen the pictures yet.
Yeah,
he's
I don't even wait. Know.
So. All right, let's get into the store.
All right.
Hey, John, how are we doing this week?
I'm doing fantastic, man. How are you?
I'm doing great. Doing great.
I realize now that we're recording this that I actually have to... like look like I'm doing fantastic. I can't say it.
Come on. You want to let me go out and come back in and you do your normal face where you're leaning on your hand and you're like, hey DJ, how are you doing?
I'm doing great, man. How are you?
Oh man, that's funny. Yep, we are on YouTube now. If you guys have If you haven't checked it out, just go Brightside Chat. It's in the show notes. The link will be in the show notes for the YouTube page. Thank you to everybody that subscribed already and the people that have been checking it out. Pretty cool. Did you notice, John? I know you watched it. I watched it. But did you notice when you go down in the show notes and you click on any of the... because we have all of the timestamps in our show notes. Right. If you click on any of them, you just go right to it.
Oh, no, I didn't notice because I didn't try to do that.
Yeah, if you do so, like if you're listening to the show and it's like
the
obviously
show notes from iTunes.
No, your show notes, like if you're on the YouTube
show notes
page
on YouTube.
Yeah, yeah, you click on the show notes underneath the video, right? And yeah, you'll see it'll be highlighted. The timestamps will be highlighted. So like when we get to FOC tonight, and when people are listening to this, you could just go to the YouTube and you'll be able to see the pictures that we're showing. You just go to the show notes and click. It was pretty cool. I thought, I'm like, you don't even have to watch the whole show because most of the show is timely anyways. But if you're in the store and you want to see what the covers look like, go to the YouTube. Boom. There you go. Pictures are right there. I thought that was pretty cool. We're new to YouTube. I don't know. Everybody else is like, duh, no kidding. That's how YouTube works.
That's how links work. Links usually take you places.
Yeah, but I didn't make it that way. All I did was take the show notes that I put on iTunes, right? And when I submit our stuff, I took the show notes, copied and pasted it right to YouTube, and then I looked and I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. It just automatically links it.
I'm sure they have their algorithm set up to look for that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, yeah, they were waiting for us, John.
I know.
Yeah, take advantage of it. Oh, there you go, showing off the merchandise.
I got that commercial with the guy with the big neck on his T-shirt? I was trying to get the shirt up so you could see it.
There you go. Yeah.
Have that too comfortable on a date looking t-shirt.
Yeah. It's...
So, I've got the right. I don't use the right detergent, I guess.
Yeah. Exactly. You got the bacon collar.
Yeah.
Is that what it is? Yeah.
I actually don't know, but
normally I have a sweatshirt on right now. It's still a little chilly up here, but today was like 60. So that was nice.
Oh yeah.
I see you got the short sleeve going. I got a nice long sleeve going tonight. So, but hey, we got
really
the merch.
All I own.
That's so all.
This is the only one I have.
That's the only one you have. That's the one I sent you, right? I didn't send you sweatshirts.
No.
No. Oh.
No.
Sorry. How about those glasses?
I don't have a lot of call for sweatshirt. Yeah, it's right there with the glass that I don't have. So,
these.
Yeah. Other people who are not on the show have them, but.
Jen broke two of them the other night.
I was down here working
and I call it working now. I'm down here working. I heard something smash and I run upstairs. It sounded weird. So I ran upstairs to check on her and she goes, it's okay. I'm all right. She's like, I just broke two of the bright side glasses. I was like, what? Yeah. That's even worse.
Those were John's.
Yeah, exactly. And they're valuable because we don't have many of them because Joe made them at school. So, yeah. But all right. Anything else exciting going on before we get to breaking news or as you labeled it, breaking news?
No.
All right. Let's get right to it then.
All right.
What do we got first?
Well, first thing, since I was instructed behind the scenes that I have to go in order.
I'm gonna leave it behind the scenes.
A robot. And, well, hey, this is you want to put it up on YouTube. This is how the sausage is made.
So, yeah. Exactly.
So the first thing is looks like Superman and Lois is going on hiatus after episode 4, which is actually next week's episode. And this is really due to... COVID interfering with the production of the season. And they are going to be replaced by Supergirl. So I don't know if this is going on hiatus until the entire season of Supergirl airs. I don't think it will be gone that long.
That would be weird.
Yeah. But it looks like it's going away for at least a little while. So, hey, thank God that their highest rated show is going off the air for...
Yeah. Now, we'll talk about it in real world. But yeah, they didn't say how long. They just said it's going on hiatus, huh?
Yeah, unspecified hiatus. But like I said, Supergirl will run for 22 episodes, I'm sure. So I can't imagine this is going on hiatus for 6 months. I would think that at some point it will come back and be on like the 7 p.m. slot and Supergirl will go to the 8 p.m. or something crazy like that. So,
don't
look for Superman.
That's too bad. That's yeah. Oh, well. All right. That surprised me.
That we'll be able to look forward to for longer. So,
yeah, there you
I'm
go.
A glass
bright side.
Full kind of guy.
Yeah. Days. Even though you don't have a glass.
I'm a can half full.
Right.
Kind of guy. So
look at you.
I try to look at things, I put a positive spin on
you. You are Mr. Brightside.
I am. So,
God. All right.
Hey, so next up, we're sticking with the CW. Looks like the live action Powerpuff Girls series.
I've been asking for this and asking for this.
I know, right? I can't believe it took him this long to get around to doing a live action Powerpuff Girls. Because if I'm not mistaken, the Powerpuff Girls are like 8 years old or something. So
yeah,
the casting here doesn't really jive with that.
No,
but we've got a couple of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. alums being cast here. Chloe Bennett and Dove Cameron have been cast. I don't know any of the Powerpuff Girls and I don't know who any of these.
I don't know if Chloe, I don't know them. Yeah.
And then last but not least, somebody I'm not familiar with, Yana Peralt. So those are your three live action Powerpuff Girls. So
I don't know.
I don't
Yana
know about you, DJ, but I'm on the edge of my, I cannot wait to watch this show.
Yeah. Well, I actually like Chloe Bennett.
The days. I like Chloe Bennett too.
Yeah. I don't remember Dove Cameron at all.
I don't either, but the headline said two alums. So I'm assuming she was one.
And I don't know Yana Peralta at all.
Maybe Yana Peralta
either.
Was the alum from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I don't know.
Maybe.
Because I'm only like three seasons into that show and I haven't watched it.
That's okay. When I was putting the show together, putting the pictures together, we almost had a Dave Cameron in our picture.
Oh yeah.
So I show notes and I was like, I'm like Googling. I'm like, all right, Dave Cameron. And they were like five of them. And I'm like, Powerpuff Girl, that can't be right. And then I look closer. I was like, Dove. Oh, that makes a lot more sense.
Now I get it.
All right. Up next, what do we got?
Looks like we're getting a Da Vinci Code prequel series. Has been ordered for Peacock. So that's pretty cool. I mean,
Tom Hanks?
I mean, I'm sure Tom Hanks is not attached to I would imagine, the Robert Langdon character here. I mean, I liked both of those movies, and I've read both of those books.
I've read a bunch of Langdon books, probably.
Yeah, I know
if
there's
not
more
all
than,
of them. Yeah, yeah, I love the books. Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know really what the setting for this is, like. When they say prequel, is it like pre Da Vinci Code or pre?
Yeah, it must be
Angels
like
and Demons, or like, is this when he's like
his college years? Yeah, yeah. I'll bet you that's what it is, because he mentions
like
it in Da Vinci
years,
Code.
And it's gonna be him, and it's gonna have a voiceover with Fred Savage or something. I don't know. Well, we'll have to see.
Right.
Once again, this would be really a cool thing where they could like young Indiana Jones this thing, and you could have Tom Hanks do an appearance. Like at the very beginning, and he's like, well, I remember back in my day, we did it like this. And then they go back to, you know, young Robert Langdon. So we'll see.
Hey. Yep.
Yeah. I'll be down.
Oh, yeah. And, oh, yeah. I'll definitely a series of that, because I love all the Da Vinci. I love the Langdon stuff, everything like that. So, and if they write it anywhere close to how Dan writes those books, I'm, you know, good friends with Dan. So.
Yeah, I was going to say, I didn't know basis. You guys were on a first name basis, but that's good to know.
Oh, all right. Let's get to this one. I love this one. This is
hysterical. This is great. So apparently viewers all set to tune in to watch Tom and Jerry with their kids last week were met with an unexpected surprise. It looks like the hard R-rated Snyder Cut Chapter 1 was playing instead of the G-rated Tom and Jerry.
Here, kids. You'd have to have seen, you'd have to notice it when you,
well, I mean, obviously before
down.
It got, it wasn't hard R in the credits. So obviously they had a chance
I hope
to,
not.
You know, to rectify this situation before it got out of hand. But yeah, this was confirmed by multiple sources. It looks like somehow there was snafu and chapter one of the Snyder Cut was leaked. So what's encouraging about that is, many of the people that saw it said that it was like the best DCEU thing they've seen to date. So,
it's just the beginning,
not really a high bar, when
right?
You're talking about the DCEU and, you know, one chapter still has it could fall pretty far from there.
Oh,
so
you've got over 3 hours left.
Yeah. No indication that this is like a great thing, but it looked like the reviews were positive on chapter one. So that's encouraging.
Hey, who knows? I mean, I've got the day slate. I know you're off on Thursday too.
I am off and I am not going to be able to watch it probably until Saturday.
Why?
Night, maybe Sunday, because Lydia's going to be out of town on Thursday. She won't come back until Friday evening. And being that it's 4 hours long, like evening may not be the time to plug that thing in. So probably, I think we're taking Saturday off, so we'll probably have to wait until Saturday to watch it, which is kind of a bummer. But we'll watch Falcon Winter Soldier on Friday night when she gets home, and then we'll watch Snyder Cut on Saturday. So
yeah.
But yeah, I'm off Thursday, and I'll be home alone all day.
Oh,
thinking, man, I got all the time in the world to crank this up to reference level and above.
And you're not going to?
I might have.
Why?
To,
I mean, you've know. She's just say you've seen the first one. You, I mean, this is
we just watch these things together.
I know you do, and I mean,
not that
I mean,
she's like anticipating. I don't even think she knows what the Snyder Cut is, or that it's coming out on Thursday. So
right,
it's probably not that big of a deal, but we'll see. We'll see. I may sneak it in.
I'm taking the day off from work for this,
just to watch it.
Yeah, well, it's 4 hours.
Well, yeah, so. It is a whole day. It is a day of work, really.
Yeah, but I built my I just built them today, as a matter of fact. The my masking.
Yeah.
For either side of the screen.
Way. Yeah.
Yep. Built the mask in black velvet. Looks really nice. Can't wait. I played the trailer a few times. I really like the aspect ratio. It's going to be a lot of fun. I think you'll like it.
Well, we'll see. I'll have to see how it translates to my 77-inch screen.
Well, yeah.
Because I don't have the 105-inch or whatever. So
it's 110. Not that size matters.
You know, yeah. That's what she said. I mean, 5 inches one way or the other makes a big difference.
John, don't go off script. I don't have a picture for that.
You don't have a picture for that? I mean, a quick Google search and you can have all the pictures you want. Just type 5 inch into Google and see what happens. It's not going to be a ruler. I'll tell you that right now.
Okay, so that was a short-lived time on YouTube.
Yeah. Yeah, we're now banned from YouTube. So.
Oh, boy. All right. Yeah. All right, moving on.
Moving right along.
That was your last one, wasn't it?
That's all I had for news.
All right.
Hopefully. It was a slow... You know, honestly, unless your
things.
Headline was WandaVision something, 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 there wasn't really a lot of news.
Right. Week. And are we going to talk WandaVision tonight? Maybe.
I mean, yeah. I guess we can get to it. But
say what hasn't been said. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's like,
but yeah, literally,
oh, I can't wait to get to it.
Every piece of news story that I read
right.
was something to do with
Wanda.
WandaVision.
Yeah. So. All right. I've got a few here. So I've got actually an article that from one of my home theater listeners sent me about Alamo Drafthouse.
Yeah, they filed for Chapter 11.
Yeah, and then this week I got another article saying that it was pretty cool that it's actually a good thing that they're filing for bankruptcy. But in the first article he sent, there was a nice quote in it. It says, "More encouraging is Sony's decision to move its release of Peter Rabbit 2, The Runaway, to May 14th. It was previously slated for June 11th. This suggests confident that most theaters could be open by then and that the family film audience is eager to return. Best of all for theaters, Sony provides a longer theatrical window than most studios." And when I read that, I thought that was pretty cool. That's the first time I think we've seen something get bumped up. You know,
right. Well, I know you don't have a picture for this, so I apologize, but it looks like Disney doubled down on, Black Widow this week too, and they are intent on that hitting theaters on May 7th. So
cool.
So yeah, there's some confidence, I guess, that they're trying to build with, you know, with the theaters. I know California can open to some degree their theaters this weekend. New York just opened theaters. So
yeah, yep.
You know, we're here in Texas because you know we're
wide open, baby.
We play fast and loose with everything.
Yeehaw!
We are at 100% wide open. So
yeah.
Yeah. So
yeah, it actually was on the news up here tonight and that you guys are wide open. And I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. And maybe, but they were showing, where's the place that we went when we were down there? Where's the place that we went to, the amusement park? Galveston?
Kima Boardwalk. Yeah.
Oh, Kima. Is that in Galveston?
It's on the way.
Oh, okay. Because they were showing Galveston. Okay, they were showing Galveston, Texas, and they were saying right. I don't know, whatever. They were in Galveston or whatever. But in the background, you could see the Ferris wheel, the roller coasters, and all that. So I was like, I think that's where we went. So
it's the same. Well, it's the same ownership that has the boardwalk. They have the Galveston boardwalk, and then they have the Kima boardwalk.
So. Yeah. So
anywhere where there's water.
You know, but they were saying how, like, the spring break is going to be hitting there soon. And
spring break is next week.
Yeah. It's going to be crazy. Yeah. Good luck.
Hopefully, yeah. I'll say we'll see.
We will see. All right, next one. You know this one. The email we got last week. It was, you know, the email that I'm talking about. I sent it to you. One of our listeners who came over from home theater, but he didn't want to be mentioned by name. So he said, I asked him, can we talk about it like vaguely? And he goes, you can quote it. You can talk about it. I just rather not my name, because it was some personal stuff. But there was one quote, and it was an awesome, awesome email. So I was like, there was a quote in there, though, that I wanted to read. And he said, when I put your show on last night, just hearing you guys talk hit me with a wave of nostalgia. Took me back to my teens and early 20s, when I'd hang out at comic shops around town, collect comics with my brother, talk movies, comics, and sci-fi with my roommates in college. And he obviously, you know, he went on, but emails like this and messages like this that we get, they're awesome. Thank you. Yeah. And, you know, he knows who he is.
Thanks, but, Deep Throat.
Yes. But we were both blown away by that email. That was great. And that's why we came up with the show. It was the idea of hanging out in a shop and just doing what we do. Just hang out and talk comics and talk whatever, you know, any tangent that comes along. Oh, yeah. So, and Lord knows there are tangents.
There are many.
Yes.
Tangents aplenty.
And the next up, we have a tweet from Martin Ferretti at Geekvine. Hey, at Brightside Chat and at Arkham Comics, do not watch the Vampirella movie. You're welcome.
Yeah. Wait, yeah.
You know what's so funny? You're like, you wrote, I think you replied, I might just have to.
Yeah,
and I was in the process, because of that, I was in the process of looking it up, see where I could find it.
He called my bluff, though, because my response was like, well, I guess I have to watch it now, because who doesn't love a bad movie? And then I actually, you know, Googled it a little bit, and yeah, it looks horrendous.
So yes, I did too.
I will not be watching.
No. But do you see the costumes?
Yes, it was really, really bad. Yeah. Hopefully what we're getting is going to
I
be
would
much
hope
better
so
than yeah what we got. Yeah.
Yeah, I would hope so. Next up, we have another tweet from Nick Wetmore at Nick Wetmore on Twitter. Oh my, Brightside Chat, and he sent a link of Arnold Schwarzenegger's Last Action Hero finally hitting 4K Blu-ray. Oh, are you interested?
Am I?
Yeah.
Not so much.
Really? I can't wait.
Yeah.
I love that movie. I have a blast. I love that. And he that's what I said to him, and he's like, I can't wait to hear you talk about it. Probably talk about it at home theater, but I love that movie.
Yeah. It's okay. It's not one of my favorites, but...
Hey, Schwarzenegger.
Hey, I'm glad to see anything coming to 4K, you know, especially
yeah
older catalog things.
Yeah.
So, you know, because it just continues to pave the way for more things to come. So,
yeah,
I'm excited on that aspect of it, but I won't rush out to buy it probably.
You just wait for me to send you the digital code.
Yeah.
All right. The last thing I have is... And another tweet, and it wasn't to us, but I thought it was pretty cool. I think it was yesterday, 3/8. What's today? The 9th or 10th? 2 days ago.
Today's the 10th.
So it was from at Superman on Film is the Twitter handle, and it's Superman on Film. And it said, which is your favorite Superman movie? And he had three listed in the poll, and it was Superman the Movie, Superman Returns, or Man of Steel. How would you vote? Everybody can see how I've already voted, because it's checked here.
You?
Yeah, I voted, and it's up on the graphic, so you'll see
it's
it. It's
got to be Christopher Reeve. It's got to be Superman the Movie.
Okay. Now, I'll put you in. It doesn't change anything, but there are 530 votes. You can't see this graphic, but there are 530 votes. What percentage do you think Superman the Movie got? Everybody's looking at it if you're on YouTube. Going
85%.
Lower.
Really?
Oh god, yeah.
Oh really? I thought it was gonna be a
that's why I put it in the show. That's why I'm putting this in the show. I voted Man of Steel.
40%, I guess.
Okay. No, listen to this. I voted Man of Steel because right now, if I had to sit down and watch a movie, I would it's more action, it's more modern. I love Superman the Movie, right? But right, that's how I voted in this particular. And I'm wondering if right other people did the same. because at 530 votes with a day, 1 day and 19 hours left at the time. So it's over with. I didn't go back and look it up, but I thought this was crazy. Man of Steel is at 90%. Superman Returns 1% and Superman the movie at 9%.
Yeah, that seems very skewed to me.
And now what I thought was funny is I voted Man of Steel and I thought it was skewed. I'm like, I thought I was trying to be maybe a little different, a little edgy.
Yeah, I was thinking 90% the other way.
So it, I was really too. I would have been too.
Considering the, like, that movie wasn't very well received by the majority of people.
Right.
And, you know, again, like you, if I had to choose today which one to sit down and watch, it would probably be Man of Steel. But,
right.
But, you know, it's kind of that thing where you go back to why you always like A New Hope, right? Like,
right.
I was 7 years old. I believed a man could fly. You know, I mean, it was like that whole thing. And we had, to that point, never seen anything like that. Our superheroes were Batman 66 and the Super Friends. You know,
right.
Like, we had never seen a movie like that. And Christopher Reeve embodied Superman. So, I mean, I think...
I just can't believe it's that
no, I
skewed.
Can't either. But again, like, who voted? Are they a bunch of 20-year-olds?
I don't know. Maybe. Maybe. You know? That's a good point.
I don't know.
Because, I mean, the Twitter handle that put it out is Superman on Film.
Right.
So his followers, the people that are seeing this, have got to be mostly Superman fans. But you're right. The age could make... That could be the difference,
you know,
right
there. A bunch of boomers voting in this. I don't know.
Yeah. So, but that's all I have. That's all I have this week. Are you ready to get to some comics?
I am always ready.
All right, John. What am I going to spend my money on this week?
All right, so I'm going to start by going all the way to the bottom.
Oh, geez. Well, actually, knock yourself out.
Well, that would work for you, too. I'm going to start somewhere in the middle. That'll really throw you for a loop.
Yeah.
All right, now, first one is Amazing Spider-Man issue 61. This issue is the debut of a new, admittedly not great, Spidey costume. Didn't get a chance to read this today, so I don't really know what the background is of this. But right now it looks like the prices are pretty much just normal at cover price. But the 1 in 25 variant is seeing a lot of movement. Seems to be selling anywhere from a low of $20 and as high as $45. I would lean towards the higher end. I sold mine today for $40. So we'll see. Like, depending on what happens with the costume, this is a potential book to keep an eye on.
Yeah.
But I'm going to let the cat out of the bag just a little bit because being a comic book store owner, I get to order books in advance. And not that this means anything as a guarantee, but like the cover for issue 62 or 63, something like that, whatever I just ordered, shows him back in his regular costume. So I don't know. Really don't know how long this is going to last.
Right.
But yeah, it is what it is. Next up, we have Blade Runner Origins, issue number 1. There's a 1 in 15 Artgerm variant that's going for between $18 and $25. So, pretty much right on ratio with that. Children of the Atom, issue number 1. There was a secret variant here. Seems to have been, I'm guessing a 1 in 5 because I ordered 6 copies of this and I got one. But
that could be
anecdotal. But the secret variant is selling for between $20 and $25. Other than that, there's not a whole lot of excitement price wise on the main cover here. But there are a bunch of first appearances, so this could have a Strange Academy type of situation happen with it, where, you know, it just starts to spike as time goes by. And at least speaking for myself, this was very under ordered. Like I mentioned, I ordered 6 copies of an X-Men title book. But I had like zero interest for this when I sent out my pre-orders and through FOC and all that stuff. So I went very low on it. Now, I didn't have a copy for the shelf other than the secret variant, because I did have people jump on board after FOC, which is always always something I love to see. So I don't know how many of these are out there. Next up, we have Proctor Valley Road, issue number one. The one to watch here is the one per store Christian Ward variant. This was selling yesterday. Had a low of $10 and then a high of $50. I think the $10 sale was just somebody that listed too low, because there's been multiple sales in the $50 range here. So I think $10 was an outlier and somebody got really lucky.
I got that graphic up on YouTube.
Yeah.
So that's the only one from Speculator Roundup, the only picture I pulled out, but that's a pretty cool cover.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's like green bowl, looks like. Is that the one? I hope.
No, I can't see your graphic, and I didn't
you didn't
this.
Get to see the cover?
No, because
I looked up the cover, Christian Ward cover, yeah.
Yeah, I ordered this book, but I didn't get the one per store variant. I guess I didn't order heavy enough on it. Yeah. Usually you get them for ordering the book, but I didn't get it.
Well, John, you can go to YouTube tomorrow and look this up, and you'll see it. Right, yeah, it'll be at roughly the 29-minute mark, I guess. Okay. I don't know.
If only there was a link or something that would.
There won't be a link directly to the picture.
It'll take me to Speculator Roundup, though, and I can find it from there. All right. And then last but not least, we have Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Jennika Part 2, number 5. That's a mouthful. So it looks like the 1 in 10 variant here there is being listed for between $25 and $30. And there have been sales in that range. But there are also sellers that have them up for less. So if you look around a little bit, you might be able to score one for a little bit less than that. But there are sales in the $25 to $30 range on this. So definitely want to keep an eye on. And that is it for Speculator Roundup.
All right. Let's get into back issue bonus.
All right. So the first thing here is just like a programming note. And that's to keep an eye on some of the WandaVision related books that have been spiking over.
I wonder why.
Yeah. So without getting into too many spoilers, a lot of fan theories did not pan out with the ending of this show that aired last week.
So unusual.
Yeah. So there's a lot of things that people were specking on that may start to lose value because they did not come true. The big keys and the first appearances are going to hold their value. You know, the White Vision cover is going to continue to hold its value.
Yeah.
The first appearances of Agatha and all that stuff will hold value. But there was a lot of other books that spiked based on a lot of crazy fan theories that didn't pan out. So just something to keep an eye on and to be thinking of if you're looking to buy some of these books.
Well.
Yeah. All right. So the first book we're going to talk about. It's a book that came out last week. It's called Eniac, issue number 1. This is a book from a newer company called Bad Idea. This book had some pretty interesting things that happened with it over the course of the week. But this is selling for about $150 on eBay right now and very, very regularly at that price. There's also what they call the not first print version, which is just a fancy way of saying second print. but that turns out to have a couple of extra pages at the end that were not in the first printing, making it essentially a first printing in its own right.
Yeah.
And so that one's going for about $50. This book, if you were lucky enough to get your hands on it, like I said, it has a huge aftermarket value. Whether that's going to hold or not is another thing. I don't really want to get into the whole story of this unless you really want to, but
I'm good.
This is the example of really what not to do if you're a new publisher in comics.
I'll take that under advisement.
Okay. Next book is Batman number 106, also from last week. This, as we mentioned last week, has the first cameo appearance of Miracle Molly, and it's selling for right now about $10, so a little over twice cover price.
Okay.
New Teen Titans, number 23. This is back from the 1980s George Perez, Marv Wolfman run. This is the first appearance of Blackfire and also the first appearance of Adrian Chase. Now, we've seen Adrian Chase appear on Arrow on the CW, but Blackfire is confirmed to be basically the villain of season 3 of Titans. Now, we got a hint of Blackfire at the end of last season, but this is her first appearance, as I mentioned, so it's selling for between $15 and $25. Next up, we have Sandman, number 10. There's a couple of first appearances in this book, but notably a character called the Corinthian. I'm sure this has something to do with the Netflix series that's being developed. But this is selling for between $50 and $80 currently. Defenders, issue 112. This is the first appearance of Power Princess. So nice. last week there was a leaked cover from Artgerm of Power Princess that had to do with the Heroes Reborn storyline that's coming up. And basically, based on that alone, just the fact that there's a cover with this character on it, who I honestly thought was Wonder Woman, because this character looks exactly like Wonder Woman.
It sounds like if you had like I just saw it a few days ago, The Big Bang Theory, and that like if you had a bouncy house with somebody that looked like Wonder Woman but didn't want to get in trouble, so you called them Power Princess Bouncy House.
Exactly.
But it looks just like her.
Yeah. So this is selling for between $25 and $35. Although a nicer raw copy was bid up to $55 yesterday.
Oh wow.
And then last but not least, we have Earth 2, number 25. This is from the New 52 run. Once again, we had a bunch of hype last week with the announcement of J.J. Abrams and Ta-Nehisi Coates working on a Superman project. Rumors of a black Superman caused some spikes on Final Crisis number 7 and Action Comics number 9. Mm-hmm. So that effect trickles down here. Issue number 25 of Earth 2 is the first Val Zod cover appearance, and it's currently selling for about $30. If you backtrack to issue 19, that's the actual first appearance of Val Zod without his costume, and that one's selling for about $40. Both of these are books to keep an eye on, especially as news of this project breaks. So cool. Again, there's a couple of ways this could go. You know, this could be the Calvin Ellis version of Superman. This could be Val Zod, or it could be a black Clark Kent for all we know. So any of these books have the potential to really rise in price depending on what happens with this project, which we probably won't know anything about for like 2 more years.
So, yeah.
That is it for Back Issue Bonus.
All right, let's get into FOC.
Yeah, so quite a bit on FOC this week, actually. We're going to start with DC, and we're going to look at Batman number 107. There's a pretty cool Francesco Mattina variant cover here.
Very nice.
Very
cool.
Very nice. Yep. We're going to move on to Batman Urban Legends number 2. This is actually, I think, my favorite cover of the week. And this is also Francesco Mattina.
I don't know. They're both pretty cool. This one's a little bit more dramatic because it has more color.
Yeah. The Batman cover is very cool, too. But I think I like this one just a little bit more.
Yeah. Yeah. I actually do, too. But it's close. They're both awesome. They're both they're really nice.
Next, we have Crime Syndicate number 2. This is the Tyler Kirkham cover.
Right.
And then finally from DC, we have Swamp Thing number 2. With the hat trick, Francesco Mattina has a variant cover.
I was going to say, this is a really nice cover, too. I didn't even know it was Mattina. I wasn't looking at notes. I'm just looking at the pictures. But yeah, that's a pretty cool cover, too.
All three of them were really cool. So.
The hat trick. Look at you.
I know, with the hockey reference.
Yeah. And you even knew it was hockey. It's pretty good down in Texas.
I know. We have hockey in Texas.
I know.
All right, a new series from DC. We have a new Green Lantern series. So issue number 1 has 2 covers. We have the next Batman, Second Son, issue number 1 of 4. with two covers.
Mm-hmm.
And then back by, I'm guessing, unpopular demand.
We have what happened
the Batman
there?
Fortnite. Well, I imagine the orders came in woefully short of what DC wanted. So
let's try this again.
So they put it on FOC and now announced returnability on all six issues. And hope that they get a much better response than
really?
What they got.
Yeah. Wow.
So yeah, Batman.
So
Fortnite,
the video game comic book crossover didn't really take off the way they thought it would.
Well, the thing is, you had a series with six issues where you had to commit to, I think, four of them before number one ever hit the shelf.
Okay.
So no sales data, no returnability. No time to market or FOC it, because as I mentioned last week, the project was announced about a week before it went on FOC. So understandably, retailers were not willing to go very deep on this. And the fact that the PDF they provided for it didn't show it to be a stellar series on.
Right.
I didn't read it, but I heard not great things about it. It was really a vehicle for people to get codes for skins in Fortnite.
Yeah, that's what you were saying last week. Yeah. And
so, yeah. And, you know, so every issue, the six issues, has a different skin for a character in Fortnite. And then if somebody redeems all six of them, they get like a seventh bonus skin. It looks like, I don't know the lineup of all the issues, but it looks like issue three features Snake Eyes from the G.I. Joe franchise.
Oh, cool.
So, yeah. But yeah, they're trying to, I guess, increase orders. So it's back on FOC.
Yeah.
The fact that it's now returnable will prompt me to order more than the five copies that I committed to last
right.
week. So so there's that.
That always helps.
Yep. Moving on down to IDW, we have another IDW DC crossover here. This is Lock and Key and Sandman, Hell and Gone, issue number one. This has yep. multiple covers. From Image Comics, we have Geiger, issue number one, with multiple covers.
That's kind of a nice cover.
It is really cool. Yeah.
The skull kind of in the mushroom cloud.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool looking.
Yeah. And then we have the Silver Coin, issue number one. This is a five-issue miniseries with multiple covers.
This one looks a little scary.
A little bit.
Looks like a horror book.
Yeah, I imagine so. But Chip Zdarsky is involved in part of the story. So that piques my interest alone. I like Chip. So, all right. From Marvel Comics, Marvel was pretty light on FOC this week. There wasn't a bunch, but they have a cool Avengers 44 variant cover by Peach Momoko. I actually like this cover quite a bit. I'm not the biggest Peach fan, to be honest with you. I know she's got
a
huge fan base out there, but I do like this cover quite a bit. There were no new series on FOC for Marvel. That's pretty much it from them.
Mm-hmm.
From AWA, we have The Resistance Uprising, number one. So this is basically volume two of The Resistance. There's two covers for this. From Boom, we get Magic the Gathering, issue number one, with multiple covers. And The Many Deaths of Layla Starr, issue one of five, with multiple covers. And then but not least, we have from Ablaze Comics. This is the next Sumerian book. This is Sumerian Iron Shadows in the Moon, issue one with multiple covers. That is it for FOC.
Oops, I was a little behind on those. There we go, the Sumerian Moon. All right. Are you ready to get into checkout?
I am.
All right. Here we go. Well, we got two books this week. We both read them.
Oh, we both read both of these?
Yep. Okay. Yep. Yes, we did. So why don't you introduce the first book?
All right. So the first book we read is Proctor Valley Road, issue number one. This is from Boom Studios. This was written by Alex Child and Grant Morrison. And it had art by Naomi Franquise, I'm guessing. So this is a horror series basically revolving around, I guess, some monsters that haunt Proctor Valley Road, which I guess is like their take on Route 66 or something like that.
Yeah, there actually was the sign for 66.
Yeah, because there was a sign there that said 66, which made me think of that.
Kind of gave it away.
Yeah. This takes place in the 70s, and it revolves around four girls who are essentially, they're trying to figure out a way to raise money to go to a Janis Joplin concert.
Right.
And through a series of different things they're trying and they're not having success, they run into some guys at a fair, I guess, and they get to talking about a strange event that happened on Proctor Valley Road, and the girls see an opportunity to basically have this as like a spook tour where they can bring their classmates there and, you know, tell them about this story that happened, and you know, all with the intent of charging them so that they can get money to go to this concert. So obviously they think this is all just folklore or story or something or other.
Right.
And they get there and they find out that that's not necessarily the case. So I'll kind of leave it at that because I don't want to spoil too much more of this. I thought this was pretty good. You know,
it was fun.
It wasn't. Yeah, it wasn't the best. You know, obviously it wasn't the best book I've ever read. But the art was good. The story was good. I mean, it was interesting enough. I'm going to go ahead and pick up number two.
Yeah.
Just to see what happens here. So I think it's a thumbs up. I mean, I definitely would recommend this book.
Yeah, it was pretty good. It was pretty good. I saw one flaw. I'm surprised. It's not a spoiler, really, because you outlined everything. I'm surprised you didn't pick up on it.
Well, maybe I did, and I just didn't talk about it. Tell me what.
So they're trying to go to a Janis Joplin concert, and the price of a Janis Joplin ticket was what, $6?
Well, I think it was like $2 per person, right? Because they said they needed a total of $8.
I thought it was like per person they needed $6, $8, whatever it was. But then they set the price for the tour,
$5 a pop. Yeah, $5 a head.
So your tour is worth more money than a Janis Joplin concert?
Right.
Like,
yeah.
I'm reading it. I was like, I just read that and I started laughing. I go, wow, these kids got greedy fast.
I thought the $5 price tag was pretty steep too. Because it wasn't like the drive-in movie, $5 a carload. It was $5 per person that they brought.
Per person. And they had a VW van. Right. They were going to load it up. And I'm like, apparently they were just going to, I don't know, make all sorts of bank.
Yeah, even just the three guys that they brought there was enough to go see two Janis Joplin concerts.
No. But yeah, it was typical, like, teenage hijinks. You know, the guys are typical guys in this any age. Never mind 70s, 80s, 90s. Typical guys. There was one line, I won't say the line or anything, but he's like, I thought you were going to, and they're like, remember the guy in the background go, I didn't.
The three guys didn't jump into a carload of four girls with the spook tour on their minds.
No.
They paid their $5 thinking that they were going to have a completely different experience.
Right. So but I mean, yeah, it is a fun story. It's I didn't think they really nailed the 70s vibe, though.
They didn't.
I thought they could have done a better job with that.
If it wasn't the fact that they were talking about Janis Joplin, I never would have got that this was taking place in the 70s.
Right.
That and the fact that in the beginning they were trying to shoplift some sunglasses, and she made a comment that she could have sold those for like a nickel or 50 cents or something.
Right.
You know, that obviously also goes back to a time well before 2021 where sunglasses are, you know, like $50 a pair. And
right. And that's at CVS.
Exactly.
Yeah. No, it is a fun book, but that is one thing that I did think of, that we've read other books where we really liked the vibe. Like, you could feel like whatever time period it was, you were like, I'm in that time period right now. And it was, and this book just didn't have that, but it's not really what that book's about. It's more of a horror book. And
yeah, the book doesn't really have anything to do with the time period necessarily, but.
Right. So, all right. You ready to move on to the next one? I can't wait to talk about this one.
I am. So, Karmen, issue number one. This is a 5-issue miniseries from Image Comics. This was written and illustrated by Guillaume March. So, Yeah, I mean, I think you like this a lot more than I did.
Really?
I didn't dislike this book at all, but I don't find it as thought-provoking, I guess, as you do.
No.
I thought this was very, very straightforward.
I didn't think it was thought-provoking. I didn't think it was like, it's not like at the end of the book, I was like, oh my God, what a, you know, when I said to you today on Twitter, I was like, oh, this would be a fun discussion because I thought it was a kind of unique take. I thought there was a bunch of stuff in there that was fun, like pop culture references. And they were having fun with it, like laughing, yeah. Trying to guess the movie, and they right. couldn't guess it. And nope, not that one. I just thought it was a really interesting take. And then the way they ended it, and it's not a cliffhanger. It's not like this, just like crazy ending. It's just one line that just made me go, "Oh wait, there's more."
Yeah, what do I have to go take care of something?
No, but it was the way she left her. It's like, I don't want to give it away because I'd like people to get there and just be like, oh, wow, because it was a fairly...
Isn't that what she said? She says, I need to go take care of something, and she left her.
She did, but right. It was the line right before that, that it was like, and I'll talk to you about it later, maybe in Kryptonite or off air or whatever, but it just like... You're reading through, and I was kind of riveted throughout. I thought it was the beginning, you know, it set the stage of what, you know, the trials and tribulations of this woman going through, you know, hardship starts when they're young. I thought that was pretty cool. So it takes you through their lifespan pretty much. And I just thought it was a very interesting take on. I don't even want to give away the subject matter.
Well, I know it's hard to talk about it, but like, what?
I have both covers up, by the way. I have the second cover by Milo Manara.
Yep.
Yeah, and it's definitely an adult book.
It is because she's naked through the entire book. So
right. The second cover, but that I'm showing right now. But I thought it was tastefully done, John.
Well, it was.
It was part of the story.
The really naughty bits were covered, although they did describe it.
Yeah, they described it, and then later on they showed the naughty bits. So it was, and they described it, but it was part of the story.
It was, and it made sense in the
exactly
story. Like it wasn't gratuitous nudity just for the sake of it, and it wasn't drawn that way, anyways. Like,
right.
She was naked throughout, but it wasn't overly, like, provocative or, you know, it was like looking at an old painting, you know.
Exactly.
In a museum or something.
Exactly.
You know, it wasn't like, you know, hustler nudes or anything like
that.
Yeah.
The cover I have up on YouTube right now is, it's the second one, and it has her, have you seen the second cover where she's flying, the woman that's naked throughout is flying? And they show her in a purple top. And I showed Joe this cover today when we were at the store. And I go, see this? She didn't have that top on at all in the book.
Right.
And then I flipped open the book and I'm like, see, look at that. It's like, it was. But I thought it was well done. And I want to see where this is going. What is this story about?
Well, right. That's the whole thing. You know, it was this woman's tragedy, really. Right. Like she. I think ultimately, because, you know, her situation is unalterable, I would imagine.
I guess.
Although, I guess you don't know, right? Like,
well, after WandaVision, I'm done guessing, John.
Well, and the thing is, you know, again, without spoiling too much, like, you don't know that her fate is sealed at this
Correct.
Point, right? This could be It's a Wonderful Life thing happening.
Right.
And
They referenced that, the Matrix, and I thought there was another movie too that they referenced in it. And it's like, it's kind of a mix up of all, Ghost,
right?
With Patrick Swayze and Demi Moore. So it's kind of a mix up of all of that. And it really is. It's like, I can think of how all those movies fit in there.
Right.
It's a really good story, and
it is.
We don't even know where it's going
yet. It's kind of out there, and
very creative.
Yeah.
That's what I liked about it.
Yeah. And like I said, you don't really know you know, it's a number one, so you don't really know what's going on or where it's going. But it's definitely interesting. Just to see where this goes. And, you know, I thought the art was really good. I like his art. You know, he's done a lot of work with DC and some of the big, you know, big titles.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of work on Batman and Harley and stuff like that. So,
yeah, it's pretty cool. Pretty cool. Really good. Really enjoyed that. That's my pick of the week, if you didn't notice.
Well, I know, because that's the show title.
One of the few times I can actually name the show before we get on air, because I'm like, this is it. I know it. So, all right. Is that you ready to get to real world? Or did you read anything else today? Sorry.
I read Joker.
Yeah, so did I.
I actually liked
number one
quite a bit. Yeah.
So did I.
I didn't get to finish the backup story. I was almost done, and then I had some customers come in, and
it took
me to the end of the day, so I didn't get a chance to finish the punchline story. But I really liked
that
the
was
Joker
pretty good
story.
Too. Yeah.
Yeah, I liked this book more than I was expecting to like it.
So did I.
Once again, with a character like the Joker, I don't expect to really be that riveted by an ongoing Joker solo story. But this kind of came at it from another direction. This did not feel like a Joker book. This really felt like a Jim Gordon book.
Right. So, but it makes me wonder where 2 is going.
Right.
Like, do we finally... I mean, I thought it was really... Was there a Joker 0?
No.
I thought I read that at the back, that there was a Joker 0, and this is a sequel to that. Like, 0, 1, 2... I don't know. I thought I read that somewhere in the book, but maybe I was wrong. Yeah, whatever.
I don't think so.
But I really liked this book. I was very surprised. Yeah. I saw it in the store and I was like, hey, you know what? I'm like, I'm going to grab that. And I didn't even know it was a Future State book. I think I grabbed a variant cover for it.
Well, it's Infinite Frontier.
Infinite
it's not
Frontier.
Really Future State. Yeah, it's
right.
Not Future
Infinite
State.
Frontier.
Well, everything is Infinite. Everything DC is going to be labeled Infinite Frontier.
Going forward.
So it's not necessarily any of those things, but. You know, it is labeled as such.
Yeah, I got the punchline cover.
That Mateena cover is really cool.
Yeah, it's really nice. Yeah. Really nice.
And then I also read Superman. So this is the new
How was that?
You know, post Brian Michael Bendis run on Superman, which I did not enjoy. This book was fine. I mean, it was okay, but it set up a really interesting scenario at the end, which I really enjoyed. And I'm kind of interested to see where it goes. So this book had a lot of Jonathan Kent in it as well. You know, him and his dad were on a mission. But when you get to the end of the book, something that they were encountering, Jonathan makes the comment to him that the next time this thing appears, Clark can't, he can't respond. He needs to stay home.
Yeah.
And Clark pushes him on why. And Jonathan comes back and, you know, for those that don't know or don't read all the other books, you know, John has been spending a lot of time with the Legion of Superheroes. And that takes place in the 31st century. So everything that's happening in this book is the past. It's all known to Jonathan, right?
Yeah.
Like, it's all history in the 31st century. So that's the first time they've really set that up, you know? Like,
yeah.
Superboy has spent a lot of time with the Legion of Superheroes in the past, but it was always young Superman. It wasn't a different person. So this is Jonathan now with knowledge of when his father dies, how his father dies, everything that goes wrong in his future is the past. So it set up a very interesting thing. He's like, you know, you can't respond to this because it's not going to end well for you, you know?
Right.
And so that's really interesting. And I'm kind of curious to see where that goes. Clark is obviously not going to back away from a scenario, even if he knows he's going to die at the end of it. And what do they do to change the future? What do they do? I'm not sure how much they're going to explore that, but I was intrigued by the way they ended that book. So I thought that was really cool. I could be more excited about it, and it could lead nowhere.
Right.
You know, but I feel like they didn't put that in there for no reason.
Yeah.
So that was cool.
Sounds cool.
And then that's really about it.
I didn't even get to Daredevil today.
I didn't get to Daredevil either. Yeah, I think that's really. Oh, I read Conan, which I, you know, I like Conan. So
yeah, you
it,
do.
It was fine though. I mean, nothing special. It's just a Conan story.
Yeah,
but it was pretty good. So yeah, that's about it. I didn't get a chance to read a ton today, but I read a little bit.
Yeah, it just hit me now that I didn't read Daredevil. I was looking. I usually save that for the end. So that I just keep reading and reading. I have something to look forward to. Then I got busy and I thought I was all caught up on my reading. I was ready to go. I came down here. I'm like getting ready for the show. I'm like, all right, cool. I'm like, oh, and now just talking to you, I was like, Daredevil was today. Yeah. So, oh well.
Well, the good news
gives
is
me
it's
something
still
to read
there.
Tomorrow.
That's right. You have something to look forward to.
Yep. I have other books to look forward to too. I got that new Spider-Man book there with that cover.
Oh, I read
on it.
That.
How was
I
that?
Read that?
How was that?
Yeah. Yeah,
I got this. It. I got this cover.
Yeah, the die cut cover.
Yeah, that was pretty cool. I didn't. I mean, that's what it looks like when you take the
right the cover slides off, which is really interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Read it, and we'll talk about it. I didn't.
Like okay,
it.
Give me a minute.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's pretty funny.
Doo-doo.
Talks amongst yourselves.
Yeah.
Talks. Yeah. All right. All right. Is that it?
Yeah.
Ready to get to real world?
Sure.
All right. What did you watch this week, John?
Well, continued my watch of Van Helsing. It was really the biggest thing I watched. But I did watch Coming to America 2, the Eddie Murphy jam.
Oh, yeah. How was it?
Yeah, it was all right.
Is it worth watching, though?
No, it is. I mean, it had funny moments, but it really felt like it tried really hard just to be Coming to America.
Yeah.
Again, it's essentially the same story, the same movie, except Eddie Murphy is now James Earl Jones.
Right.
You know? But yeah, you know, don't think too hard about it because the guys that were 90 years
old. Who are you
old
talking
in the first
to?
One, you know, the guys right. that were 90 years old in the first one, 30 years later are still. 90 years,
the same guys in the barbershop.
Yeah. So that was a little weird.
That's funny.
But yeah, they squeezed pretty much everybody that was in the first one. They figured out a way to get them back in this one.
Now are they going to make another one 30 years from now? And the guys in the barbershop need no makeup, but the younger versions of them do.
Yeah. They're going to be de-aged.
They'll
instead.
De-age them because that was a big deal back then that everybody was like, that's Arsenio and Eddie Murphy right there in the barber. Oh, man, that's crazy how they did that. And then it's like, now you look
right,
and go.
30 years from now, that's how they will look.
That's, yeah. Actually, it'll be funny 30 years from now if you see them and go, that's pretty accurate.
Right.
They did a great job.
How did they know?
Yeah.
So yeah, I watched that. We watched that new show, Debris. Did you watch that?
No.
I think it's on NBC, I want to say.
Ooh.
There's two episodes so far. I watched the second episode was Monday night. It's an alien kind of ship falling to Earth type of show.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's actually really good, though. I enjoyed that quite a bit, so you should check that out.
I just wrote it down. Put it in my notes.
Of course, you know, we'll get to WandaVision, but... You know,
oh, you did watch it. Good.
Watch the big WandaVision finale. And yeah, I mean, besides that, it was just Van Helsing and, you know, our regular network shows.
Yeah. Did you watch, did you see The Flash last week? And
I did see The Flash and I did see last week's Lois, you know, Superman and Lois.
And what'd you think of episode two?
I didn't think there was much of a drop off of episode two. I still liked it.
Okay.
I know you were. You had a little bit of reservations, I guess.
Okay, here's what my reservation was. It's like we were already in episode two, and it was like a cookie cutter of one with the kids. Like, didn't it feel like in episode one, like they had like turned a corner with the kids, and the kids were like more accepted. Okay, so we know Dad's Superman, and we're accepting of it. And then right away, it was Jordan went right back to being that like upset kid. When it's like, where did all the progress you made the week before?
Well, he got the news that he wasn't special, right? But
that's what I mean. It's like, and now it's like, oh, it just, he kept, and then they had to keep placating him, and they're right. Constant. And I'm like, that's the only issue. I love the show. I love both episodes, but I'm like,
right.
Don't do this every week where it's the kids are okay. And every episode, I haven't seen this week's yet, but every episode is okay. The kids are upset about something. We solve the problem. And then next week the kids are upset about something. And then we solve the problem. You know, I'm hoping that's not it. I got a little nervous where it was like, Jordan's upset again.
I don't know if you've watched a CW show before, but they pretty much have a formula that they stick to. Like, I'm not sure if you've watched The Flash yet, but
yeah, I did.
Yeah. I mean, these shows are all very formulaic,
right?
But yeah, I don't know. I mean, I definitely see what you're saying, and you know, I haven't watched this week's either, but
right.
But yeah, I don't know. I liked it though, and you know, yeah, like you were saying, I didn't really see much of a drop off in like the effects or the production quality or anything. I thought that seemed to stay pretty consistent. Looks like they really put some money into this series.
Yeah.
Much more so than they have within. They're really kind of banking on this.
Well, so far they've only made 4 of them.
Well, right. But that's
what they haven't told us yet.
This is probably their tentpole series going forward because, you know, Supergirl's coming to an end. You know, a lot of these shows, Arrow came to an end. Flash, even though it got renewed for next season, is, you know, it's on its downswing. So I think this is where they're putting their money. And I think they have to now be mindful of the fact that HBO Max exists and they are also developing superhero shows. So
right.
They have to up their game a little bit when it comes to that.
Oh yeah.
You know, we'll see.
But, and the shows could end up over there. So they know eventually they could end up there.
That hasn't happened it's all the same with entity. Any of them yet, but
no.
You know, cuz they still seem to be going to Netflix. But who knows how long that'll last.
Right.
In Superman and Lois being a newer show, their streaming rights may already be assigned to HBO Max.
Right.
So we're not really sure. So we'll see. But yeah. But yeah, I like that. Flash was fine. You know, it was just picked up where the last season left off. So
I saw this week's episode. I really liked this week's episode. Yeah. But yeah, last week's was, I thought that was pretty cool what they did with, what's his name?
Tom Cavanaugh.
Yeah. Tom Cavanaugh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sherlock.
Yeah, I love his characters though.
Yeah,
like he's so good at that. And like, and what was it last week's episode when Barry had to do all the characters?
Yeah, Barry did a pretty good job.
Yeah, he did
most of those characters.
Wait till you see Barry in this week's episode.
Yeah.
Oh God, yeah, yeah. And the ending of this week's episode, really, you know how they do the Flash logo, and then they come back with what's coming up next, like a little, not a clip, but you know, like a. End
like a
credit
scene kind of like Marvel
stinger scene. Exactly. This week's stinger scene. I'm like, yes. All right. Good. I'm excited.
Okay. Cool.
Happy. Happy. All right. That's Superman, Lois, Flash. Have you seen Clarice?
I have been watching it. Yes.
CBS or
that
Paramount Plus.
Paramount Plus now. Yeah. Yes.
I like that show.
I do too. What's growing on me. I wasn't in love with it after the first episode, but it's starting to, I thought she was tried really hard to be Jodie Foster.
Yeah.
In that first episode. And,
she seems more relaxed now. I'm all caught up. The four episodes.
Yeah. I think she's kind of, growing into it or maybe I'm just settling into it.
Yeah.
And you know, that could be, but yeah, I like it. So far I've been enjoying that.
I like how each episode is a story unto itself, but it is, you know what I mean? Like they solve
a thread, right?
There's a thread, but they solve an issue and then you move on to the next episode. But yeah, there is a longer story at play here, which is interesting. But there's a lot of callbacks to Silence of the Lambs. Anytime they take a picture, you get that bulb flash noise in the background.
Cool. Yeah.
Her coat, did you notice like that she's wearing the green coat? That's very reminiscent of the coat that she was wearing in Silence of the Lambs.
Yeah.
I really love the, like, I like what they're trying to teach her throughout the series. And they're like, what you did in, they don't say Silence of the Lambs, but how you went off on your own, you're like, that's crazy. You don't do like that.
Her boss is kind of dressing her down for that. Like,
yeah, but he's doing it in a good way.
You.
Yeah.
Right. He's like, I'm not jealous of you for what you did. He says, this is why I'm mad at you. And
right.
It makes total sense, right?
Yep.
Like everything he said, you know, it's like you put yourself in danger. You put all your agents in danger.
Yep.
And then it plays out in the episode where she learns the lesson, you know,
hey, yeah.
You know, this is right. I shouldn't be doing this.
Right. So. Right. And it's kind of cool how they take that. They actually take the Silence of the Lambs movie and go, well, she did it all wrong.
Right.
She saved the girl in the movie, spoiler,
right.
But she did it wrong, you know.
Right. Well, it's kind of like that, you know, to create a sports analogy, right? Like if you have if you're a rookie pitcher and you come up and you throw a perfect game in your first game, like
right.
The rest of your career is only downhill from there. Right? Like that's not the starting point.
Right.
And that's kind of like her, right? Like she came out of Quantico and she pitched a perfect game. And
right.
Now she has to learn how to be an agent. And that's.
Yeah. Know. But she kind of cheated the system too. She
right.
didn't like,
right.
like you said, it's like, yeah. So yeah, I like the story. I really do. And, it's on Paramount Plus or yeah. CBS. Let's see what else. I haven't seen anything else. I haven't caught up on Resident Alien. Big Sky's on a delay still.
Yeah, I've been watching Resident Alien. Hey, did you catch the Big Sky Silence of the Lambs connection?
No.
You know the wife on Big Sky?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. That's the girl in the well.
The girl from
the
well, yeah.
Oh, yeah, I knew that. That poor woman, she can't pick a guy, right?
I know, right? She goes from Wild Bill to
right.
Wild whatever his name was.
Yeah, it's like, exactly. She's like, she helps one guy try to get a couch in a van.
Yep.
And in another movie, she marries the wrong guy.
Yeah. And falls in love with the other wrong guy. You know,
yeah.
She dances,
I know.
You know, dances with the other guy. She could really pick him.
Right.
So, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, you know what I wanted to ask you? Have you seen that Kevin James show, The Crew, yet?
No, I added it to my... I did add it to my stuff list on Netflix, so I can watch it. But like I said, we're watching Van Helsing, so... I think at this point, 10 episodes into season 3, and I think there's 3 left, and then we'll be into season 4, and then we'll be caught up with that. So we'll probably get through most of that.
Joe's going to kill me
next week.
I can't remember the name of the show. He's been asking me to ask you. It's on Hulu. It's an anime, Japanese anime show.
Probably haven't watched it then.
The book is... We were in the store today and he showed me the book. The book is actually backwards because it's in, you know.
All the manga are backwards.
Yeah, it's all backwards to us.
Yeah.
It's on Hulu, I think. It's
could
got
be
four.
Attack on Titan.
Yes, that's
one.
It. That's the one.
I haven't seen it.
Yeah. He loves it.
I know
loves
it's wrapping
it.
Up. Yeah, it's getting ready to wrap up.
He's all caught up on it. And he's telling me I got to check it out. So maybe that's one you and I can do together.
Yeah, was at one point my number one selling manga. Was Attack on Titan for a long time, but it's kind of fallen to other things now. But yeah, very popular book.
So. Yeah. So yeah, he's watching the show. Him and his buddies talk about it all the time, and he had a picture. His buddy texted him a picture, and he goes, "I can't show you." And I'm like, "Why?" He goes, "It's a spoiler for season. It's a tattoo, and it's a spoiler for season 2." And I was like, "Okay." They love it so. Well, maybe you and I can do that. We'll go through it.
Well, I'm really looking forward to. We're about 2 weeks away now from Invincible. I think that's
the football movie.
20s. No, the Amazon Prime animated series. not the football movie. Yeah, I can't wait for Invincible.
That threw you for a loop.
It did. I wasn't expecting that.
I could see your face.
Yeah. So can everybody else too, because we're live. Well, we're not live, but we're recorded. We're recorded. I wasn't expecting that response, but I think that drops on the 26th, if I'm not mistaken, which is, I guess, 2 weeks from Friday. I don't know if you've seen any of the trailers for that. It looks awesome. I love this comic book so much. I really can't wait for this show. And it's got like the voice cast, like all-star voice cast. I mean, it really looks great. So definitely one that I'm going to be talking about in a couple of weeks. So hopefully you'll be watching that as well.
Yeah. And is it dropping all at once or?
No. I don't know. But I imagine it's Amazon Prime. So we'll probably get two or three up front, because that seems to be what they like to do. And then we'll get the rest weekly, I would imagine. I don't even know how many episodes are in the season.
Right.
But I know the comic itself ran for about 150 issues. So there's quite a bit of story that they can tell. You know, it could really go on for quite a while if it is popular enough. So hopefully it will be.
Cool. Yeah. All right. That's all I got.
Yeah, me too.
You're all set. Are you ready to get to some WandaVision? Spoiler free?
Yeah, I'm ready.
You're ready? All right.
I am. WandaVision!
All right, John. Spoiler free, how would you sum up this entire season?
Well, I loved it. I know you're a little disappointed.
I loved it, though. Yeah. I am disappointed, and you know why. We'll get to that in Kryptonite.
We've talked about it. Yeah, well.
Yeah,
we'll,
and I nailed why I would be. I said, if that's what it is, I'm going to be disappointed.
Right. And I said, that's what it is.
Right. And you're like, no, you said it could be.
Well, I was pretty sure. I was pretty sure, especially going into the finale. I was pretty sure.
Oh, yeah, that week. No, I was talking like week two.
Even in the beginning. Yeah, right. Even in the beginning, I was like, I really
we'll get to this in spoilers.
This was going. Yeah, I know we'll get to it in spoilers, but what I think is that, like, this is actually, you know, this is spoiler free, I guess. You know, it's kind of getting roasted online, right? Like, a lot of people were very disappointed with the ending of this. And I really feel like this is like another Last Jedi or Force Awakens kind of scenario where people build their story up in their mind and then are disappointed when they don't get what they think they were going to
get. Yeah.
And this is a case of fan theories running wild that didn't pay off. And to the point where the producers and the writers of this show going into the finale were cautioning people to not let their fan theories overtake them.
Right.
Because it, you know, it was becoming very readily apparent that people were expecting something that they weren't going to get. All that being said, I had already, you know, we talked about it last week. I had kind of already made clear that if it ended the way I thought it was going to, I was okay with that because I liked the way it was going. But yeah, I don't know. I was very satisfied with it. I mean, of course, there was. I would have been happy if other things had come true.
Correct.
But, but I really liked it. Like I said, I was not disappointed at all. I still think this sets the stage for a lot of things to come.
Yeah, we'll talk about that too. Yeah. Because that's the thing I think this did is as much as we all, as everybody, ourselves included, had our own theories as you're going through it, I think that's the magic of the show, pun intended, was the conversations it sparked. I mean, you and I said how many times that the fun of this show is the conversation. If you just binge this show now, you are going to miss out on probably 90% of the fun that this show really was.
Right. But I also think that conversation ruined it for a lot of people.
That it had, would always
they had
ruin
too
it,
much
though.
Time on their hands. You know
right.
what I mean? Like,
right.
If it was there to be binged, people wouldn't have had time to formulate all these.
I don't
crazy
care
theories,
about those people, you know? Though, because there are.
Well,
I mean,
don't either, because I mentioned. I think we were like on episode 6 or so, where I said I give up and I'm just right. here for the ride, you
yeah.
know. And I ended up enjoying it a lot more because of that. And it's one of those things where, again, I'm going to kind of go back to Star Wars with this, in that it doesn't matter what they delivered on this show. They're not going to make everybody happy. You know, in this day
they
and
never
age,
do. Yeah.
Right. In this day and age, you can't have the perfect ending to anything, because mm-mm. somebody is always going to think it should have gone a different way.
Well, in this day and age of social media that's open to like 6 billion people,
right.
You get a million people that love it and a million people that hate it. And everybody on both sides feels like they're completely vindicated when you're both still in the minority right. in the world, right. you know? So I thought it was just so much fun. We had a blast and I don't have a problem coming up with theories, coming up with ideas. Right. That's what we do on this show about everything, right?
Right.
And what are we wrong like 99% of the time? And it's that one time
always.
That you know what I mean? You'll be like, hey, we were right about that. Hey, that was cool. Okay, move on. But right. it's that's part of the fun. If you're just going to sit there like a vegetable and watch these things and go, well, that was really good, and not get emotionally involved. Yeah, there's going to be highs. There's going to be lows. There's going to be disappointments. And I don't think there's nothing wrong with that. But like you said, it's like the people that are getting angry about it and they're like, they shouldn't have done anything. They did what they did. And I think, spoiler free, I think what they did is you can still have all your fan theories, because all this show did was it simplified. It was 1 week in time, right? All of those fan theories could still come true elsewhere.
Well, again, I think I said it last week. This show existed only to take Wanda from point A to point B.
Right.
Right. You have to show how Wanda gets from the end of Endgame to the beginning of Doctor Strange 2.
Yep.
Right. Because in Doctor Strange 2, she is going to be radically different than the last time we saw her in Endgame. And
yeah.
without this show, you don't know how she got there, you know?
Right.
And that's what this show was all about, you know, and the writers and the showrunners who I listened to the director. He was on Fat Man Beyond with Kevin Smith and Mark Bernardin for about 2 hours talking about this show and this series. And, you know, they had a story to tell, and it didn't jive with what people thought
right.
it was going to be. They talked about the whole Evan Peters thing. They talked about a lot of things, and that wasn't the story they were telling. And he recognized the fact that coming towards the finale, that a lot of people were going to be disappointed with,
right.
with the resolution that they got, but they had reasons for telling the story the way they did. And there was a purpose they were trying to serve. And, you know, he feels like that's what they did. Now, of course he feels that way, right? Because he directed it.
Right.
But it accomplished what they were intending to accomplish, not necessarily what all the fans were intending to accomplish. So, and you know, again, when we start to watch episode one, like, this is already done. Like all nine episodes were completed. It's not like they were changing things as
right.
people were coming up with
yeah.
theories, you know?
Yeah, this isn't
they're
the just, 50s where they're filming yeah. live and they can
they're
change on the fly
back,
later.
Sitting back looking at social media going, oh my God, this is not going to be this, you know?
Right.
And they're like, these people are going in the wrong direction, and, you know, but what can you do? That the train's already left the station, you know?
Right.
It is what it is.
I'd be enjoying it. I'd be laughing.
Oh, they did.
Oh, they're going the wrong way.
Yeah, they did, but they knew. Again, to the point where they put a caution out there towards the end that maybe you shouldn't be so wrapped up in your fan theories.
Right.
Because it's not going to be that. So,
see, I wouldn't tell people to not have fan theories. Just
no.
Hey,
but it, I guess it was
just
understand
that those understand. Are just fan theories.
Exactly.
You know,
caution them to not be too disappointed. When,
we're not. Yeah. This show wasn't done at request. Like,
right. Right.
It's not, you make your ending.
Although he did say something which was interesting, and it goes back to something I said right at the very beginning. Their intention was to have dropped the first three episodes at once. Whereas, remember, we only got two, but the reviewers and the critics got three. And, you know, after two, we were kind of like, well, what is going on here? And everybody was saying, well, just wait till episode three, because that's where things really come around.
Right.
Well, they intended to have that for people. But because of COVID and because of post-production, they couldn't have three ready in time for Disney Plus. So that's why it didn't drop that way. But I remember saying, well, if the reviewers got three, why didn't we get three? Because that must have been how they intended people to see it.
Right.
And it really was just a timing thing. Like Disney Plus said, look, if we can't get this to you, if you can't get us to this by this time, we can't air it because,
right,
you know, we're not going to meet our deadlines or what have you. So so I just thought that was interesting because that was a question from the beginning, you know, why they didn't give it to us that way, because that's obviously how they wanted us to see it. But, right. You know, that COVID.
Yeah, it's kind of screwed some mistress. Things up, but
yeah.
All right, there's a lot I want to get to when we get to spoilers. So you want to wrap that up? You want
to
wrap this up then? All right, alrighty then. We can. We'll be back next week here on YouTube again. Hi everybody. But you can find us on Twitter at @brightside_chat, or you can email us at thebrightsidechat@gmail.com. And you can check us out on the Nerdy Legion at nerdylegion.com, us and all the other great podcasts over there. And that'll do it, John. And as you could see on Twitter, you can talk to John at Arkham Comics, COMIX. It's underneath his name.
Yeah. So. Look at that. Convenient.
Convenient. Go to YouTube. And subscribe, please. That would be great, too. So anything else, John? Any final words before we lock up the door?
Autobots, roll out.
Hey, Fred. All right, John, is the door all locked up?
The door is locked.
I thought you were going to have some act this week. Now that you're on YouTube, I thought you were going to pretend to like come back from doing the door or something.
I'm not that method.
All right.
I can't be bothered to stand. You know.
It's like, once I'm sitting, I'm sitting. That's it. All right. 126.47. Just had to make a note there on timestamp. All right. Where did you want to start with spoilers? There's so much.
Wherever. Just dive into what you want to get to.
All right. Let me see. So the visions. Yeah. Let's start with that one.
Okay.
For now. I really like, did you catch that? I didn't catch it the first time I saw it. I've watched it twice. I watch it with Joe the day it comes out, and then Jen and I watch it later in the week. And I didn't catch the quote that Vision said when he was saying goodbye. And he said,
what did he say?
He said, I have been a voice with no body, a body but not human, and now I'm a memory made real. Right. Who knows what I'll be next?
Yeah.
No, and I was awesome. Like, isn't it? I'm like, because it took them all the way through the MCU.
Right.
And it's like, I thought that was so cool. And I think what really blew me away is I missed it the first time.
Right.
I was like, you know, because he's just speaking and, you know, it's an emotional moment. I probably couldn't hear him through the tears in my eyes, you know.
Yeah. It was pretty rough.
But it was a tough scene. But at the same time, we have White Vision gone. And right. that, I mean, I think that's who he basically transplanted all his memories.
Right.
And or opened up the memories for White Vision. So now he is Vision, no?
Right. I think this is just Vision going on in the MCU. Like, this is how he's brought back to life, basically.
You know? Right.
And I think this is going to be Vision from now on. I really liked their standoff. You know what I mean?
That was good.
You know, there was, you know, of course the battle, right? Like, they're fighting each other, and they realize, or Vision, Red Vision, I guess, realizes, like, this is a standoff, right? Like, neither one of them can defeat the other, right?
You punch me, I phase. Right. Punch you, you phase.
Right. And so, you know, he poses this philosophical thought experiment.
Which is awesome. Which
was awesome. And you know, basically it opens up, you know, I hate to say Red Vision, White Vision, but I don't know how else to classify them.
Well, that's
but
what
it
they
opens
are.
Up his eyes, right? And you know, he you know, realizes that he's been manipulated by Hayward, and you know, he
see, I didn't take Vision, it that right? way. You know how I took it? It's basically the same thing, but I took it as you have Red Vision versus White Vision versus Vision, right? And I think Red Vision realized he's talking to himself, who is, for all intents and purposes, a computer. And so what he did is he spoke to him on that rudimentary level for a computer and said, if you're here to kill me or Vision, I'm not Vision. You know what I mean? And right. what he did is it kind of sent a computer into that. What was the movie where you send War Games. And he sent the computer into the battle where it just kept working out the problem.
Right.
And that's basically what he did to him. And it really didn't. I don't think it made him realize Hayward was the bad guy. I think it just made White Vision go. He couldn't work out the problem because Red Vision was right. You know what I mean?
Well, right. But it opened his eyes to the fact that Hayward was trying to use him as a weapon.
Yeah.
You know, and, you know, it's a familiar thing. Like,
you're right on that.
You've seen it in War Games. It even goes back to Star Trek. It happened in Star Trek. Like, that's how you defeat a computer, right? You feed it a logical problem that it can't reconcile.
Yeah.
Like, in Star Trek, it was a similar thing. And they fed the computer the statement, this statement is false. And that sends you into a tizzy, right? Because if the statement is true, then it can't be false. You know, and
it's, and
the computer can't reconcile that. And so that's what happened in War Games, and that's kind of what happens here. They go, you know, he brings up the ship of Theseus, and they talk about that, which I thought was awesome. Right.
Right.
Because, like, again, age old philosophical question. If you,
you and I were talking about that last week.
I know we always talk about the ship of Theseus, right? But yeah, I really liked the way that worked. But here's what the only thing that threw me a little bit about that scene was that, like, okay, if I'm White Vision, right, and all my memories and all my thoughts are opened up to me now, right? Because that's kind of what happened, and he realizes. I am Vision. I have all your thoughts, all your memories. I was built from, you know, all your pieces. I'm Vision. I would think that he would run to Wanda, but that's not what happens. He flies off and we don't see him again. Like, we don't know what happens to him. But, like, if I have just been awakened and I've got all those thoughts and memories and feelings, quote unquote, because I don't, you know, he's an android, but. He loves what? Like, why doesn't he go to the woman he loves? Why does he fly away? So I thought that was.
Yeah. Well, he might also,
odd, you know, but.
Yeah. I don't know. I didn't.
But, you know, they're going to meet again, right? Like, that's not the end of
course.
That story.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah.
And then the question will be.
I wanted to know why he didn't phase through the window.
Yeah, right.
I did. I was like, he just smashed through a window. Like, why?
The interesting thing going forward will be if Wanda can accept him as Vision. you know,
for all intents and purposes,
when she first saw him,
yeah,
she did, right? She's like, "Are you Vision?" And I looked like she wanted to kiss him until he grabbed her by the throat or whatever.
No, he squeezed her melon. He was like,
"Yeah," squeezed her head, but it looked like she did accept him,
right,
in that moment. But now, after everything that's happened, will
he's a little chalky,
him?
But yeah.
Yeah. Will she accept him again? So,
but if he really is Vision, can't he change that appearance anyways?
Well, I would think so.
He could make himself the red one again.
Yeah, I would think so. But I don't think how he looks will be the sticking point for Wanda. it'll be, you know, whether she thinks he's Vision or not.
For all intents and purposes, doesn't he now have every memory Vision had, with the exception of when he left, and from there Vision just walked back and disappeared?
Well,
so he doesn't have the goodbye. That's it.
Right. I thought about that, but then something else kind of occurred to me too, in that if Wanda created him, right?
The fake
from chaos magic, right?
Yeah.
And then Vision, I guess, transferred his memories to him.
Well, I think he opened them up, unlocked
right,
them.
Because
right.
Because my question is,
because they're already there. They're just
would
hidden.
That only be the memories that Wanda thought he had? Or
maybe. Yeah.
Would he have all of those memories? I'm not 100% sure.
Right.
If he awoke something that was already there, or if he kind of transferred his memories to him.
Right. So he may not have any memories of the hex.
Right. Right. He might be incomplete, but
which is fine, really.
Yeah.
Except for the boys.
I thought that whole interaction with them was great. I thought that the whole Wanda and Agatha showdown was great. Now, that's where you were more on target than I was, because I kind of really thought that she was going to be, I don't consider her to be like the big bad of the show.
Cause right.
The big bad of the show was Grief, really. That's
right.
That's the big bad. But
right.
She wasn't a good guy. Like, I thought she was going to sort of take over as like a mentor for Wanda, and she didn't. Like, were right in that she wanted that power. Like, she was trying to absorb the powers. But I thought that whole scene, the showdown, was great when they kind of pull back and reveal the runes on the the hex. I thought that was awesome. I thought all of that was great. I thought the resolution with Agatha was great. Like, we're definitely going to see her again too.
Right.
Or at least if they don't bring her back, they're making a mistake. You know what I mean?
Because I thought
she did a great job.
They did everything to do all the stuff that you were talking about, like make her a mentor.
Right.
You know, they left. That's what I mean. All those fan theories that we had, even though they didn't come true here, this is an instance where it's like, you can totally see what, just Agnes's, she was Agnes when she said it, her line of like, you're going to need me. You're going to need, you know, you don't know what's coming.
Right.
That's all the stuff that we wanted to come by episode 9.
Right.
You know, and like the idea that she's not even the most powerful person. There's somebody pulling her strings, right? All of those fan theories that we had, they were summed up in her line there that will take place somewhere else at some other time, you know,
right?
Which I thought that was really cool how they did that.
Yeah, I love that they set up, Agnes set up that, you know, Wanda was more powerful than the Sorcerer Supreme, which I thought was pretty cool. So I liked that aspect of it. But yeah, you know, obviously something Wanda did, you know, unlocks what they're going to face in that movie, I imagine, right? Like whatever she did that she doesn't know yet is what's going to take place in the multiverse of madness.
You know,
so did she fracture the multiverse? Did she, you know, we don't really know what she did, because we won't find out until we get to that movie. But, you know, there's repercussions that I feel like she's going to have to go back to Agnes, whatever. You know, bring her out of the hex and, you know, find out what's going on. So.
That was another question I have for you. The whole Agatha thing. There's so many questions about her and I don't call them plot holes. I don't call them story flaws or anything, but like, I still don't understand how she knew to find her, how she knew to go to the hex, how she knew that this was going to happen.
I still really just feel like as a witch, she's tuned in. It's like the
you
force.
Think?
You know what I mean? It's like, I just feel like she felt the disturbance in the force, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I think she was just drawn to it. You're right that
they don't explain it. Right. And that lends me to think it's something bigger than that, that right. the, you know, when she explains it later, when she shows up somewhere else, she'll say like, this is what's coming. And the reason I knew is I was trying to get your powers for this reason,
right.
because somebody wants them or they, you know, it's, she's worried. I picture her as somebody like Loki in Avengers, like right. in the first Avengers movie, he was working for Thanos at the time. But he didn't, nobody really knew that. It wasn't a big reveal. I think we did know Thanos at that time. Maybe he was in the end credits at that time. But
because he was in the end credits of Age of Ultron, I think was the first time we saw Thanos, right?
I think it was the first time we actually saw him. But who was he? Like it wasn't Thanos that he walked up to. Because remember in the, at the beginning of Avengers, he walks up the stairs in space. At the very beginning, but it wasn't him. It was the guys working for Thanos at the time.
Yeah, the...
what do you call them?
I can't remember what they're called.
Yet, yeah, but anyways. But his, it was all henchmen, a prelude to Thanos, right? But they hadn't still done the big reveal yet. So I have a feeling that's kind of what, like, Agatha is going to be. And it like a Loki-type character.
Yeah, it definitely could be. I think she is the Loki of the next phase. Like, you know what I mean?
Could be.
But yeah, I don't know. Again, my gut tells me it was just a,
yeah,
like I said, a kind of like a disturbance in the force. I don't know how else to say it. But, yeah, you know,
a disturbance in the magic.
Yeah, that she just felt and was drawn to it. You know, it's like I said, very powerful magic that if you were tuned into that, you know, you would feel the ripple or what have you.
Right.
Because I still don't know. You know, who is she working for? Like, we don't really know.
Right. We don't know. They haven't said they, all we know is it's, there's something bigger. Cause she did say that. She's like, you have no idea what you've done.
And it could still be Mephisto. We don't know.
Oh yeah.
We don't really know the plot of Multiverse of Madness at all. We don't know anything about that. So,
all right. The boys, let's talk about them. The two boys, we hear them. And the last scene, the last end credit scene, you can hear them calling for her.
Right.
Calling for help. So they exist somewhere?
I'm guessing, right? Like, they're, like, where do they go? Right? Like, we don't know where they go when she basically lowers the hex, right? The chaos magic means that she created them in a real sense, right? Like, that's what Agatha said.
Well,
like,
then
you created this. So do they cease to exist when they disappear? Or are they, again, are they part of the multiverse? Are they from another reality or dimension? Don't know, but
that's where I was kind of leading you.
Yeah.
Right. The multiverse of madness.
And she's, you know, she's studying the Darkhold and hears them. And, yeah, we don't know, but I have a feeling that that's not the last, you know, obviously that's not the last we see of them.
Now, wouldn't Vision be there?
Well, it could be, again, because, you know, he says we've said goodbye before, so it stands to reason that we could say hello again. So who knows? But then isn't that just WandaVision all over again? Like, I don't know.
Right.
I don't know that they're going to reverse everything they just did to bring them all back again.
Right.
I just don't know. That's the whole thing.
We'll get to that in a second, but
yeah.
The what I liked is I really liked how they did a better job of it in the show than I'm about to do on this show, but they did a really good job at getting rid of the boys.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That would have, they put them to bed and then they went off to say their goodbye. And you just know in the background that the boys go in their sleep, the right. boys go away. So you don't, but they showed you earlier on when the hex was coming down and they were in the street and they were like, mom, mom, you know, and yeah. it was, that was emotional, kind of basically foreshadowing what you know is about to happen anyways. Right.
Right.
But the way that I'm like, how the entire time after that, I'm like, how are we going to get rid of the kids? I this is going to be awful. And I thought it was very like tastefully done in that it was still emotional.
Right. And it was very sitcom, right? Because again, going back to the sitcom where, you know, you just turn out the lights and they,
right.
and it's like you're, you know, in the old sitcoms, you turn the lights out on the stage and that was the end of the show.
Right.
And that's kind of the way I felt about that. It's like, you know, we turned
yeah,
out
that's
the
a good
lights,
analogy, yeah.
the door and you just, now the thing, the question is, did they go peacefully or did they go screaming and we just didn't hear it, you know, because like in the street,
right.
Like it wasn't a pleasant experience for them.
But they were trying to get to her in the street. I like to right. think that they were asleep.
Or did they know? Like
right.
did they know what was coming? You know?
Right.
Who knows? Because I love the line.
But now they are screaming for her.
Right. Thanks for choosing me to be your mom.
Yeah.
You know, I really love that line. You know, get you right in the gut. But when you say that to them, like, does that not indicate to them that something's, you know,
something's afoot?
Something's not right. Yeah.
yeah.
Because mom's put me to bed a lot of times and she's never said that. So,
nope.
you know.
Nope. Nope. Yeah. yeah, that was weird. But yeah, it's, I just thought it was really well done because I was expecting a more, I don't know. I can't say a more emotional scene, but I didn't know how they were going to do it, especially right. being on Disney Plus and right. have, you know, they already had that scene in the street, like you said,
which obviously she couldn't take because she right. didn't let it happen. You know,
she wasn't ready to let it happen yet. Yeah. She was just pulling the hex down for a little bit to let people right. out. Yeah. Let's see all right, before we get to that, costume. What do you think of her costume?
Loved it.
Awesome.
Yeah,
and
I loved
she had, I liked how at the end, like she had like two different versions. Like the first one she changed into, I really liked because the cape came out from like her waist. Did you notice yeah. that? Like she had a cape in the back. She was wearing pants, but from behind it looked like she was wearing a dress. Right.
right.
So she had a cape from the waist down.
Right.
And then, later on at the end, when she flies away, she had a like Little Red Riding Hood on with the cape right. all the way from her shoulders, all the way down, but right. still the same front, you know, dress costume with the pants and everything. And and the crown that she wore.
Right. Cause again,
everything was awesome.
That had the potential to look corny,
yes.
you know, based on how it looks in the comics. And we kind of got it in the Halloween costume
yeah.
episode, but I really liked the way they did it. You know, here, I thought it looked great. Yeah. I thought the costume was awesome.
Yeah.
You know, again, can't wait to see more of that. You know, I'm just sad that we're done with Wanda for a year, you know?
Well, that was the next thing I was going to say is about, what did you think of the idea of like, they told us a while ago that WandaVision was going to be one season and one season only.
Right.
And it was. And here's the thing. I think one of the most creative things that they did with this, aside from, I mean, we've talked ad nauseum from episode 1 to 9 on how creative each episode was. But as a season as a whole, have we ever had a season this complete, this good, and then at the end said, we don't need anything else.
Right.
We don't need a season two because there
don't
can't be. There's no hex.
Right. Don't need a season two of this show necessarily.
We want more Wanda.
Right. Like I said, she's going to continue into Multiverse of Madness and who knows what else. Right.
Right.
Like we don't know what part she plays in the MCU going forward. And I could see a world where we got another Wanda show post Doctor Strange, but yes. It wouldn't be what we just had.
It wouldn't be WandaVision. It'd just be another, be a Scarlet Witch show, or it would be
again, that character. But again, you can say that with any character in the MCU, but you know, I guess now, arguably, with the exception of maybe Tony Stark, you know, Wanda is now the most well-developed character in the MCU, right? Like, we know more about Wanda than pretty much anybody.
Yeah.
So
it is the first show.
Well, right, but I'm saying, are they going to double down? Like, I don't know that they'll give us another Wanda show. Like, how much Wanda do they want? You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, depends on how important they want her to be going forward. But I know we would like another Wanda show. But, you know, we're also going to get Moon Knight, and we're going to get She-Hulk, and we're going to get all these other things. Who knows? But, you know, I know we said this before, too, but, you know, I'm looking forward to Falcon Winter Soldier in a week. Don't get me wrong, but it is not going to be WandaVision. You know?
Well, here's a funny thing. That nice segue, because that gets into what we talked about with spoiler free, in that I was a little disappointed at the end of this.
Yeah,
because it wasn't as dramatic as we thought, or it could have been, right? I said in, what was it, episode one or two, when we were talking about it, and I said, if this just turns out to be a grieving widow, I will be disappointed.
Right.
And at the end of the episode, I was like, It really was. I'm like, that's kind of disappointing. Like, there was no big or bad. There was no other motivation. Nobody manipulating her to do something. It was just like a grieving widow that just got upset for a week, you know, and wreaked havoc, basically. And when I thought that, I was like, well, you know what? With everything you're hearing and stuff, I don't think there's going to be as much of a letdown to Falcon Winter Soldier, because I don't, you know, if had they done a lot more and developed the MCU further, I think there would have been a letdown, where this just turned out to be a grieving widow story unto itself. Okay, now we go on to Falcon Winter Soldier, and I think that could be just as good. I don't think we're going to have this fan speculation talk. I don't think,
well, that's the whole
I
thing.
Think a lot You're of people have learned have... the lesson. I think you and I will.
Right. Well, but it depends on what there is to talk about. But I still just don't think there's the mystery there that we're going to be. Like, I just don't think we're going to be trying to decipher the meaning of that show week after week.
Right.
I think the meaning of the show is pretty cut and dry. We're going to get great action scenes. We're going to have a lot of fun with Sam and what's his name? Bucky.
Oh,
couldn't think of his name.
I was trying to think of his real name.
We're gonna have all the Lethal Weapon buddy cop stuff going on with those two, and it's gonna be a lot of fun. But I just don't think it's gonna have the emotional weight that WandaVision had.
No.
I still think, you know, WandaVision was something very different and you know, kind of special, I guess. And, you know, I just don't think that gets replicated with Falcon Winter Soldier. We have the potential to do something similar with Loki.
Yeah, you had said that before,
You know, in the sense that we may have, you know, the wild theories again, like that we had with WandaVision. Now, like to your point that you just made, maybe we've learned our lesson as a collective we and won't
Never.
Be seeing Mephisto in every around every corner,
right?
when we're watching Loki, but who knows?
So let's get to a second here. Let's give a little time to Paul Bettany, and the havoc he created.
Yeah, I think unwittingly, but maybe not. You know,
well, I think it was unwittingly. And then I don't think he realized what he was saying. I think it was
not a bad joke.
I think he was trying to make a joke, and he didn't realize the joke was going to turn into what it turned into.
Right. Well, he even said that. He's even said that after the fact.
He said, you ever said something? And I went, oh, that didn't go over the way I thought it would.
Yeah. He didn't realize the hell he was unleashing.
Oh. And there was rumors of a Remember, and I don't think this was Paul Bettany that said it, but there were rumors of a Skywalker-esque appearance at the end.
Well, and that's what a lot of people are. That's why a lot of people are really upset.
Where did that come from? You know,
it's like, most of what I read this week, as far as complaints, were that look, we didn't get this cameo that we were promised.
Nobody promised it.
I don't remember what the origin of that was.
Right.
Like, where did that start at? Because maybe that was never supposed to be a thing either. And everybody just took it as a fact that that's what it was going to be. I don't know. I don't remember who said that or when. But yeah, at the end of the day, we didn't get that. You know, the biggest cameo we got was Evan Peters. And that was kind of early on. And then a lot of people were really mad about that because he didn't turn out to be
anything.
You know, Quicksilver. He was nothing. He was Ralph. He was
Ralph. It's like
he was her husband, Ralph. Beavis and Butthead, because he goes boner, which I thought was funny.
Ralph Boner.
He was just husband Ralph that, you know, kept getting referred to. But yeah, so people were upset about that, but. He was the biggest cameo in the whole thing. And, you know, again, listening to the director when he was talking about the show, how, you know, so many things they were able to keep a surprise, except for the biggest surprise they had, which leaked, you know, right from the beginning. And, you know, he was talking about the lengths they went to try to keep that. Like, he was like ferried to the set in a hoodie and, you know, Matt, like they really went out of their way to keep him a secret. And that thing leaked right at the very beginning.
Right.
But then all the other stuff, you know, they were able to keep under wraps. So,
well, there wasn't anything else that big.
No, but,
and people were too busy guessing other things. It was like it, you know, it was the shell game and everybody was guessing the wrong thing and nobody was looking at like, oh, it's just Paul Bettany at the end.
Right.
No, he's already in it. Yeah, I know. He does another cameo.
But listening to him again, the director, and I can't remember his name now, but he was talking like the whole aerospace, the engineer thing where everybody like went crazy thinking it was Reed Richards. He's like, he was talking about like that was never the intent. Like the intent was always to be just this woman that they introduced. But he was talking about it like he spent like a year working on the special effects for that scene with that rover.
Yeah.
And was super proud of that. But then as the episode was airing and they were leading up to it and he was seeing all these fan theories, it's basically like his heart was sinking because he knew that what he thought was really cool was going to be a giant letdown to everybody because it wasn't Reed Richards. And
I thought that rover was ridiculous.
Yeah, but it's just like, you know, it just goes to show that, like, they thought they were doing something really cool with that.
Right.
But it got completely derailed because people's speculation just took them in a different direction.
But see,
no matter what he did, it wasn't going to be good enough, you know?
But to be fair, they brought a lot of this on themselves. They have to know better. You put in a, like, I know an aerospace engineer. You got to know that the MCU fans are going to go crazy. Like, who going to be? Who is it? Who in Marvel is an aerospace engineer?
Yeah, I guess. But
and then
it
the other
was funny
one,
listening to him talk about, you know, like I said, how he was so kind of so let down by that reaction because he was really proud of what he did. And, you know, it just didn't work out in his favor, you know?
Yeah, I just had another one. I just lost it. I can't remember. There was another one that they had done that it was their own fault. Oh, that's what it was. What's his name? Quicksilver.
Well, that's right. You don't bring him in and think that people aren't going to jump to conclusions.
But not only that, he turns out to be a nobody living in an attic, right? But they actually have a stinger scene with him going, Snoop is going to snoop.
Right.
And you think he's going to take her down. And he turns out to be nobody.
Well, but he did take her down. Like, he captured her and held her hostage until Monica freed him from his delusion, basically. Or his, you know.
Well,
she pulled the beads off of him.
Pulled the beads, right.
It released him from her spell. So when he said snoopers were going to snoop, he was working for Agatha under her spell. So right. he was something in that particular scene, and he did hold her hostage, you know, in that attic until...
Right, but you would think somebody that was going to take her hostage would be a little more powerful or a little bit more of a somebody, and especially yeah. as a big cameo.
That's
like
true,
that,
because I'm not quite sure how he was able to overpower her.
Right.
Although he did have super speed.
Yeah, he did the boom and sent her across the... Yeah, he had super speed. He could do... I don't know.
Which, again, is just something that Agatha gave him. You know,
I guess
she bestowed
yeah.
I imagine she bestowed those abilities on him because he was supposed to be her, you know, Wanda's brother.
Right.
And I guess her magic was able to control his mind and give him super speed. I don't know.
Yeah.
So
we kind of touched on a little bit. Where's everything go from here? What do you think?
Well, I mean, it's hard to say, you know. I mean, I think that we definitely see Vision again, and I think he becomes Vision, you know, that we kind of...
I don't think he stays the white Vision.
Well, whether he does or not, like I mentioned before, he stayed white in the comics for quite a long time.
Okay.
So maybe he does, maybe he doesn't, I don't know. But I think he becomes basically... You know, Paul, he becomes the Vision, and...
Well, let me ask you this.
This
Where's...
was just the way to bring him back, but I don't know where he shows up again is going
right.
to be the question.
Where's the Mind Stone?
Well, it's gone, right?
No. They're not all gone. Didn't Captain America go, Steve,
well,
take them all
right?
the pieces
he
back?
He put them all back, right?
So where's the Mind Stone now? Is it in the Tesseract again?
Well, I don't know. That's a good question, because if he put everything back, in theory, he would have put it back in Vision's head, but Vision was dead, so...
Does he get the stone back then?
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe. But I don't think he needs it anymore. Like...
Well, he kind of...
just gave him... It really just gave him his life. Right?
No, like, but that's what he said. He said it in WandaVision. White Vision says, you have the yellow stone. I have the memories.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm wondering if that was like a prelude to what's to come. Does
yeah, I don't know.
Is that well, what gets him? Does he get the yellow stone and then maybe he then turns into the Red Vision?
Yeah,
I hate to go down this road of speculation, but
right. Well, it just depends on what Steve did with it. Like, we don't really know.
Right.
Like,
well, it has to exist somewhere.
Right. And everything was supposed to have been put back to where it was taken out of, you know, the timeline or whatever. Right.
Right.
So, in theory, yeah, it probably he wasn't able to put it back in Vision's head because Vision was gone, so it probably went back to the Tesseract. But where is that?
Right.
You know, that's the question for Loki to answer, right? Because, you know, you've got the Time Authority or whatever. I would imagine that's going to play some part in that. Although I don't really know. I don't know. Yeah, it's a good question. I just feel like they're not going to go down the Infinity Stones rabbit hole again. Like, we've already been there, done that, you know? Like, going forward, we have the Eternals. We have a completely different set of things. So I'm not sure that we're going to backtrack and go back after those stones again. But, you know, you still have the Guardians of the Galaxy and... you know, another Ant-Man movie. So it's like we haven't said goodbye to all of those characters. But, you know, again, in
theory,
there
is a transition coming.
We're not supposed to see Captain America again. We're not going to see Black Widow or Iron Man again. So, although, again, Kevin Feige has said that this is not the last Avengers movie. You know, there will be another one at some point. You know, whether that's a Young Avengers or what, we don't really know. But. I don't know. Like I said, I don't know past Doctor Strange. I don't know what role Wanda plays going forward. I just don't know. You know, it's really hard to say. Based on at least the movies that have been announced for the next couple of years, I don't think we see her again except for Doctor Strange. But
you never know.
You know, I don't think she's in, you know, I don't expect her to be in Black Panther 2. Don't really expect her to be in Ant-Man 3.
You never know, though, because, I mean, look, you know, Bruce Banner shows up in Ragnarok.
Yeah.
And, I mean, that was a story. So, or they use different stories from the comics for that.
Right.
I wouldn't be surprised if she shows up anywhere, to be honest.
The thing is,
but
I think, well, she is, I think Wanda plays a huge part in whatever comes next with the X-Men, you know?
Yeah.
Whenever the X-Men get introduced, I think is where we see Wanda again, you know, in yeah. some kind of substance, you know what I mean?
Right. That's a great point
and
we should have touched
coming.
On earlier.
Right.
Yeah.
That's definitely coming. You know, we know we're getting a Fantastic Four movie. You know, I don't think she's a part of that necessarily, but I would imagine once we start doing X-Men that Wanda, you know, is definitely going to have some kind of role to play there. You know, she was never officially a member of the X-Men, but, you know, again, she's a mutant and definitely, you know, is that where we see the Magneto connection? Like, I don't know. But I think that's where we go from here with her.
Right. Yeah. And we also have the tie in the Stinger scene there with Captain Marvel. That's going to be coming up.
Right. Right. And you know, the boss is Nick Fury, right? And I mean,
yeah, they kind of, I mean, that was just laid out there. They yeah. like my, the boss, he, and they even like, they, I mean, they overemphasized that he would like to
yeah.
like you to come up there. I thought that was an awkwardly acted
I mean, there's a
scene
there's
pointing
potential
up
for it to be the Ben Mendelsohn character, right? Like that could be her boss, but
yeah, but
the I've, boss of the Skrull that we saw. But I, right. I get the sense that it was Nick Fury.
Yeah, because he was friends with them, and or it
right.
still is. You know,
right.
at first until that, you know, character says he. Which was only like a half a second. I thought right. they were talking about Captain Marvel, you know.
Yeah.
But it was literally having they go, he would like to see you. And you're like, oh, okay. It's definitely Nick Fury, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. Like I said, I thought maybe it was, is it Talos? Is that his name?
Yeah. Ben Mendelsohn.
Ben Mendelsohn.
I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. So I thought for a second it could be Talos because that would be her boss. Not,
yeah. But Talos was down here. He remember him Far From Home? He was
right,
here.
But we don't know what's happened next because
right.
we're getting the Secret Invasion show with him and Nick Fury. So obviously they connect together again. You know,
Far From Home. When did that took place? Roughly around the same time as WandaVision, didn't it?
Right. Where we know from the end of that Nick Fury is up on the Skrull.
Up.
Ship.
Right.
Right. Up.
That's what I mean. So it's like. Because I'm
but
trying
again,
to think
maybe,
of
maybe Talos has made his way there too at that point,
right.
You know,
yeah.
Because they are going to have to hook up together because they have that show coming,
right?
And then how big, you know, does Monica? You know, we know that she shows up in Captain Marvel too, but I could also see her playing a big role in Secret Invasion. You know,
yeah.
So,
yeah.
You know, who knows what happens there?
Yeah, it's going to be. We need more.
Yeah,
and we get a week. We get 1 week, and then
yeah,
we get
more.
Falcon
yeah.
Winter Soldier.
Yeah,
and then what? Loki's in what? May?
Loki's. I think it's June 11th now, isn't it?
Oh, was it? I can't remember.
Yeah, I think it's June. It was originally May, but I think when they announced the date, it was June.
11th. Yeah.
May 4th, we get Bad Batch.
May the 4th be with you.
Yeah, May the 4th, we get Bad Batch, but then
yep. Cool,
which should run concurrently with. The beginning of Loki, I guess.
Yep.
I don't know how many episodes it is though. So
cool.
But yeah. But you know, Falcon Winter Soldier, I think is only 6 episodes, if I'm not mistaken. So that'll end.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's awful.
So that's
too short. Like
the end of April. So we go all of May and half of June essentially before we get. So
maybe they're all an hour long.
Oh, maybe.
I don't know.
I think they are because I think they said that the like the sitcom type shows were going to be like 9 half-hour episodes and the drama shows
Oh, okay.
Be like hour long episode. Essentially, you get the same amount of time. You end up with 6 hours, basically.
Right.
Either way.
Right.
It's just, you know, you get 6 1-hours or.
Right.
Although I don't necessarily think WandaVision was a
sitcom,
not a drama. Yeah.
Right. I mean, exactly.
But, you know, I think they said the She-Hulk show was going to be like a 30-minute format.
Right.
But, you know, Falcon Winter Soldier, I believe they said was hour long episodes. Yeah. So.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Is that it?
Oh, I think so.
It was a long one.
Yeah.
We got a warning here on our video.
We
you
do.
didn't see it, did you? Did you get it on your side?
I wasn't looking.
Oh, I got a warning on the screen. Are you still here? Oh. I'm like, yeah. I had
Are
a
you
click.
Still watching?
So like on the YouTube video, Netflix they'll menu. See like yeah. half of each of our faces got blocked for a second because a little warning came up like, are you still here? Yeah, we're still recording. Jeez.
Yeah, we're still here. We've never gotten that before.
No, but they didn't hang up on us this time either.
Oh, that's true.
I'll take that.
Yeah. Let's say we're not any longer than we normally go.
No. No. No, but it actually stuck with us the whole time. That was pretty nice. I'll take
Don't jinx it. We're not done yet.
Yeah, we're not done yet. So. All right. That'll do it for this week.
I think so.
All right. Let's get out of here.
All right.